this was something that I announced the other day, not recommended to upper year sociology major students, which now isn't really, doesn't really matter because you're here already. You're stuck, right? There's no way that you can, I mean, you can drop it, I guess. But the reason that I say this is because there are a number of good sociology courses which deal with Korean society, more in-depth analysis. So if you're like, if you're Korean, if you have studied sociology for 4 years, you already know a lot about Korean society. So this class is kind of like offered to the students who's a beginning year sociology major and also who has little, maybe, knowledge of Korean society and culture. So we begin with very basics of sociology as well as very basics of Korean culture. Okay, so for many of you who are very mature in terms of your 학번 or your knowledge or whatever, this might be, well, I already know this, and why should I sitting here? Well, I have warned you, right? Okay, already. So, please be patient when you learn something that you already knew or you have learned when during your high school days. Okay, so 너무 쉽다고 불평하지 마세요. Okay, 내가 이미 경고를 했으니까. Okay. Please refer to the syllabus, okay? Yeah, this is something I already explained the other day, but let me just quickly go over. So we will have some snapshots of Korean society today, okay? So very descriptive statistics, some description of some pictures, and we will be watching some video clips, very basic video clips. Hopefully, we can make some arrangements so that the students in Shanghai can also watch at the same time. So we will try to provide very basic information of the current state of Korean society. Okay? So nothing serious, but at least we should know who we are and where we are. Okay? And then another very important aspect of this class is that we should think about history, society, culture. They're not static things. They are something, it's kind of process. It changes over time. So I don't think there is such thing as anything, such thing as Korean culture as something that we can catch. It's something that constantly changes over time. So maybe what, for example, we are seeing, for example, at Korean University, we are seeing a lot of exchange students from all over the world, actually, right? I was kind of surprised to see that I got almost like more than 30 emails from foreign students saying that, well, I'm an exchange student here, and like I should take a course, but and I had to say that, well, because of the seat availability, I cannot do anything. But it was something that didn't really happen a couple years ago. So I guess, I don't know, I mean, I think it's a very important factor for remaking of Korean culture, because Korean culture, as I said, is a process, will interact with other actors, other culture. So when we have maybe many exchange students from China, from the US, from England, from Sweden and Germany and so on, They bring their values, they bring their behaviors and so on, and so they interact. And then kind of there should be kind of reshuffling and remaking of Korean culture. If you said, well, Korean culture is like something of like 16th century, I think that's wrong. It's something that constantly remaking by interacting with other actors and other cultures, mass media and so on, okay? So the social change that Korean society have experienced over the past, at least maybe 56 years or 100 years is very important in making ourselves, that is, the Koreans and Korean culture. So, for example, we have been encountered, we encountered maybe, what, in the early 20th century, what did we have? Korean nation, Korean state, what was important historical event of the early 20th century? First half of 20th century? This is what I'm going to be doing here. So Turkey, early 20th century, what kind of historical experience do we have?
한 번만 더. 한 번만 더. 네, 제가 못 알아봤어요.
20th century, like first half of 20th century, what kind of experience, okay, did Koreans have?
World Cup?
Yeah, I think there was a World Cup. Yeah. 20th century, first half of 20th century.
21st century, where we... Korean War. And
okay, maybe Korean War. What year was Korean War?
Korean War between North Korea and South Korea.
What year?
In 1950.
Okay, so before that, before the Korean War,
1920s, 30s? The 1930s. I don't know exactly events that, well, that is very traditional things.
It's like very difficult question, yes. Very, because he wasn't born then, so like my question was unfair. Okay.
Wasn't that a Japanese colonization?
And I know. Were you there?
Oh, no. We just landed in Vienna.
Yeah, it's Japanese colonialism, right? Okay. Good sir. I think he's like such a deep, very thoughtful thinker. So he had like, you wanted to have something very important, like difficult, abstract answer. And I mean, that's kind of, I think that's the kind of tendency that I find. That is, many Korean students are very smart. I mean, you'll see. Yeah, they're very smart, especially, we'll talk about the education system and like I've been studying in the U.S. and I've been like in Australia and so on for my graduate program. But I realized that Korean students are very smart, very hardworking. And actually, I just got a phone call from my former student. He's a graduate student at Cornell, and he'd been talking to for 10 minutes about like how much he knew a lot. He knew a lot compared to other students. But he couldn't really talk. Like he said, "Well, this is frustrating." He knows that he knows much better on certain issues, but he wasn't able to really express himself for 1 year. And I think that he's getting much better. But anyway, Korean students are very smart. Oh, at KU, no, you'll see, very smart student. Then, but it's kind of like difficult for them to like. It's quite common that we find it very difficult to speak in the class. So whenever I ask questions, it's like mostly the students from other countries. Like, I mean, it's good. I mean, it's like, I think, so that's what I'm kind of encouraging. That's why I'm trying to encourage Korean students to like speak and participate. I guess because of Korean education system, which is test oriented, not really encouraging discussion and talking in the class, maybe a factor. But I think, please feel free to like make some like interesting comments or sometimes stupid questions. I mean, I think there's no such thing as stupid questions. It's like part of learning process, and we'll see that students from other countries will like really actively participating and raising their hands and like desperate to like. it's like they're like. Hermione, like in Harry Potter. Yeah, I was reading Harry Potter with my son for the last 1 year, and like a couple times from book one to book seven. Yeah. Anyway, okay. So I think it's like that kind of very positive, like very active attitude is very important in learning. Like, try to ask questions, make comments, respond to the question. So please, I will be like asking, and I know that it will be like non-Korean student will like try to raise hand, like raise like Hermione, yeah. Okay, anyway, so it's like Japanese was, Japanese colonialism in the early 20th century was very important part of Korean history. So what happened? What happened in the when Japanese was occupying Korea in terms of culture? What was the most critical thing that they have done to Korean society? I know that there's somebody who wants to.
Wasn't it like all the Koreans had to speak Japanese?
Yeah, that was very important, I think. That's very important. I mean, because in learning a culture, there is no such no important, no more important thing than language, I think. I hope like that many students in this classroom who do not speak Korean, please try to learn the language as much as possible. And that's the first, I think, door, first gate to learning a culture. And that's what exactly Japanese did. They just banned Korean language from schools in official context. So Koreans had to learn Japanese and language. And I think that really changes everything, our cultural identity, right? And we had to change also names to the Japanese style names. I think that's kind of a very important effort to like eliminate Korean culture in Korean Peninsula. So, and I think many years have passed today, but still this past experience of Japanese colonialism has affected Korean, many aspects of Korean society. For example, language. Do you know what Mahura is? Mahura? What's Mahura?
Muffler?
Yes, okay. If you go to like a garage, auto service center, they say, they still use the term Mahura, Mahura. And what's Mahura? It's muffler. It's muffler, the car, muffler. Like, you know that what muffler is in the car? It kind of deals with, it reduces the noise level, I think, right? Is that? 소리를 줄여주는 거지, 아마. 그 noise level of your exhaust system, muffler. No? May not be English, or I don't know. It's muffler. And then Japanese kind of Japanized English into like Japanese style pronunciation and Mahura. And that kind of was used in Korean society in the 20th century and still is used by the mechanics at the car auto service center or pyonto, pyonto, okay? It's pento, Japanese language, still widely used. Takwang, takwang, I think it's like Japanese, right? So you'll see these many languages that are used during the Japanese colonialism are still part of Korean culture, if you will. And even though I had no experience of living under Japanese colonialism, still I have some ambivalent feeling, I must confess, you know, because my grandfather, I lived with my grandparents and my parents when I was young, and in the now maybe 1970s, boxing was very popular, boxing. There was kind of, very often we had this Asian championship, and somehow it was like Korean versus Japanese boxers. And like it's when we had this boxing game on Saturday evening, a Korean boxer versus a Japanese boxer. It's like very important festival, or maybe very important fight. You know, it was like something that we should win. And we'll just sit around the TV and cheer for the Korean boxer. And so, even though, I mean, I was a little kid and I had no real, like, direct exposure to Japanese colonialism, I would be very like excited. I would say like, what kind of cheering, like go Korea, like something like that, or fighting, like it was much more like explicit and direct. 죽여, 죽여. That's like, kill him, like that's for a little kid. I mean, who had like little whatsoever direct relationship with Japan, had this kind of words that I kind of learned from my grandparents, and I think that somehow should have like changed or affected my attitude toward the Japanese. Okay, so of course, and later on, I began to learn history academically and so on. So maybe I became more, I became to have a more deeper understanding of like the history and maybe a different way of looking at these issues. But still, I guess, in deep in my like consciousness, if you will, I might have some like leftover from this kind of exposure from my grandparents, grandfather. Okay. So social change over the past several decades are very, social change is very important. So we had Japanese colonialism, the U.S. We had 3 years of American military government from 1945 to 1948. Many of you may not realize, but for 3 years, Korea was like ruled by the American military government. Okay? I think the whole society had to restructure around this American power for three, direct power, for 3 years, and I think that might have really affected whole society, and we had imported this American educational system, and you may know that after the Korean War, many many Korean elites have been sent to the U.S. to get trained higher education in the U.S. So most ministers of Korea in the 1960s and 70s, they were actually trained in the U.S. Okay, so well, there has not been enough like research done about this, but I think we can assume that their training in the U.S. directly or indirectly affected Korean education system, and that might have led to today. So this kind of historical experience is very important, okay? So social change over the past several decades at least should be examined to understand Korea today and Koreans today. Key features of Korean culture. Culture, what is culture? It's a difficult question. We'll deal with it in a kind of simple way. But I just want to say that there's some simplified version of Korean culture, like saying that, well, Koreans emphasize family, Koreans emphasize we, the group, rather than individuals and so on. So we will kind of like try to have a very simplified stereotype, if you will, of Korean culture, and then try to provide more nuance to the concept of Korean culture as a very dynamic process, as I mentioned earlier. And hopefully, we can provide some explanation for social change, like what is the mechanism of Korean culture, social change in Korea, okay? Well, next topic is, more serious. How are we going to study Korean society? Well, even though I'm a sociologist, I respect history. So this is what I have just explained historically. Things change over time, okay? Things change. What happened in the past constructs the present, okay? That's, I think, it's very common sense, but it's important that we should understand the time framework, time axis of understanding Korean society and culture. What happens now actually will affect the future. So it's kind of continuation of what's happening, accumulation of what's happening. Well, so this is a photo, not very clear, but if you can look at this, Tapgolgongwon, right? Tapgol Park. Have you been to Tapgol Park? This used to be called something else, right? Tapgol Gongwon. Do you know where it is? 종로 2가 혹은 3가지, 그죠? It's probably only like 15 minutes, 20 minutes from here, Tapgol Gongwon. So what is Tapgol Gongwon? It looks like an old, quite an old building, right? Any, do you know anything about, in terms of history, in terms of history? Or right in front of Tapgol Park, Tapgol Gongwon, there is a very big building for you to learn foreign language. Oh, it's interesting that nobody knows about this. It's very basic. Do you know where, have you been to Tapgol Park? No? Have you heard of Tapgol Park? So what is
I don't know about the meaning of that part. No, I don't know.
Yeah. Tapgol Park. Any?
It is known for 독립운동. What is? Is 독립운동 in English? Independence movement.
Yes. like this park, this building has been there for quite a long historical time. But this became quite popular because we had in 1919, right? In 1919, there was very important historical event in Korean history. What was it? Yeah, 만세 운동, 그죠? On the first day of March, which is Independence Day. Many Koreans were on the street demanding independence. So that's where many, especially many young people, and have gathered to have manse, like long live Korea, and like they were peacefully waving their Korean national flag, demanding independence. We have the right to be our own, and so on. So it's a very historical. The important place for Korean history, but looks like not many people are really interested in this issue, I guess. Now, in the 21st century, early 21st century, this place also famous for something else, not for the independence movement, but for today, this place is widely used by certain population of Korea. Do you know? Okay. You're from? Right, yeah, it's okay. okay. But maybe, yeah.
Elderly people? Elderly people.
Yes. So you can see that even in this photo was taken, I guess, to show this particular building. But you see, Jan, sorry. you get. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I guess. Ah, 그래. But he told me to stand here. Yeah. Okay. 여기서? Okay. Ah, 질문할 때만. Okay. Okay. Yeah, it's quite demanding, yeah, challenging. I'd like to be free. Oh, okay. That's me, all right. Yeah. So even in this photo, I guess, which is taken in order to show the building, you'll see there are a couple. Actually, there are three elderly people. Okay, three elderly people. I think you should go and visit this place. I think it's a very interesting place to visit and maybe look around, because they have some many important historical artifacts here as well. And also actually meet the elderly people who just sit there playing Asian chess or Go and so on. Paduk, Jangi, this kind of things, and just hang around there, because, and maybe you'll see hundreds of the elderly people, just like sitting there, just hanging around, killing time, and so on. Right? You can see that this actually, you will see this beautiful pagoda, which is like national treasure number 2 here. So this place actually, I think, it's a fascinating place, because it's accumulation of hundreds and maybe thousands of years of Korean history, not only the independence movement of 20th century, but also you'll see this national treasure here. Also another very important monument of the 15th century. As I said, March the 1st, we had this independence movement, and you'll see this statue there at this particular place. Okay, all right. Another piece that's showing this independence movement. Very in contrast to this kind of historical, very old historical, beautiful buildings and statues and so on, you also see this elderly people. They're becoming, I think, many people who come here every day to spend time, this shows one very tragic aspect of a Korean society. There's many elderly people in the 60s, 70s, and 80s. We'll talk about this demography of Korea, but they have much longer life expectancy, but they have no jobs, and they often are alienated from Korean society, from their own family. So they come here, and they're poor. They can get sometimes free lunch from nearby areas, shelters, and they sometimes develop into this kind of political activism. So this is a this particular photo was taken when these elderly people gathered, and they showed their strong hate toward North Korea. They said, well, so they have this anti-communist, very not all, but many of them have this very strong anti-communist feeling. And so they sometimes they build kind of political power in terms of even national politics. So it's, I think it's really fascinating how this particular place has developed into something totally different from the 20th century and the 19th century. You see that this, you know, this is this elderly people there, and they have like free lunch, some free lunch place, and also very cheap restaurants, so they could buy like for some lunch they could pay 2,000 won and then have lunch and so on. They come every day, and because they don't feel comfortable staying at home with either their like daughter-in-law or wife and so on, so they just would rather come here and like spend time here and so on. And they are the ones who are very important actors for Korean development in the 1960s and 70s and 80s. And they many of them have this kind of frustration that they have like worked very hard. They have invested everything that they had to their children, but there's no like social network that would provide them like a good elderly years. For example, when maybe in the 19th and early 20th century, we had very strong family ties, right? So the parents would do whatever they would do for their children's education, right? And then there is, I think, kind of implicit assumption that if you take care of your children very well, they will be, the parent will be taken care of later when they get old. So in a sense, it was kind of rational behavior to provide everything to their children. But time has changed, right? So for this particular generation who are in the 70s and 80s, I think they had done everything to for their children, but things are not as same as it was. So the young, their children say, well, no, I don't want to like live with my parents, my father and so on. So you'll see this number of one person households are increasing very rapidly, 1인 가족, 1인 가구. And on the one hand, of course, people who are in the like 20s and 30s, but then on the other hand, there's like these people, these elderly people, they live by themselves, which is very unique way of residence in Korea. This is kind of very new thing, which began to took place in the late 20th century. So they don't have this social network they used to have. So instead, they would just come out and come to places like Tapkol Park and just spend time and then like express their frustration with their state. And this is actually right in front of Tapkol Park. And it says ybmsisa.com, right? 종로상가 있는 거 맞죠? Okay, so have you been there? Any of you been to this place? ybmsisa? No? 별로 공부하고 싶지 않은 거예요, 그죠? So this is a very big language institute, right? It's Hagwon. So many young people go there. It's like right across Tapkol Park. So it's a very big contrast. We have this very old Tapkol Park with elderly people and sometimes people who continue to like try to leave the past. And right across the street, we have this very big building teaching foreign language from English to Chinese and Japanese and so on. So, and then maybe average age of the people who come here is very low, very young people gather here. And I think they have very different view, a very different value system, if you will. So as a sociologist, I think it's just, this area is a fascinating place. I strongly encourage you, not only a foreign student, but also Korean student. I mean, if you haven't, I thought all of you knew this place and all of you have been there, but looks like maybe not, I don't know, but you should have a tour of this particular area. It's actually near Insadong, where you could find good souvenirs like Korean cultural artifacts and so on. But anyway, this place shows how different history is accumulating in Korean society and how different the populations are actually. So even though we say Koreans, that tend to very simplify diversity of Korean society and Korean people. So the people who come to this YBMCSA Language Institute have maybe very westernized, very globalized, very individualized value system, whereas the people who come to Topkapi Park right in front of this building, people in the 70s and 80s, maybe they hold on to the value system that they have acquired when they were young during the Japanese colonial period, or maybe even Korean War, if they have gone through the Korean War, that they have a very strong feeling against North Koreans and communism and so on. And it would be very difficult for them to actually talk to you. Maybe I think about 7 or 8 years ago, I had a tour to this place with some students that I taught. These elderly people were very willing to actually listen and talk to the young people, because there were probably 12, 13 of us at the park. Like, everybody was looking at us, like, because the average age of the place was 70, 80, and then suddenly these young people from KU came, and they were just like looking at us, and so when we approached them, they were willing to like ask questions, why you're here, like, and they would like to talk and so on. So I would encourage many of you to visit and have a tour of this area in order to appreciating the Korean history and the difference or diversities of Korean society, even within this very small area of Korea. Okay, let's take, because some of you look quite tired, let's have like 7 minute break. We'll come back at 6 p.m. Yeah, I think especially for this class, Understanding Korean Social Structure and Culture, it's very important, or I would strongly encourage you to really interact with each other, which I find that during the break, you talk to each other and like get to know each other is very important, because culture, especially culture, is something that can be learned it's by textbooks and like literatures and so on, but also probably more efficient ways to actually live through by interacting with other people and like conversation, going to dinner and a drink together and so on. That's very important. So I think I hope and I do believe that it's quite possible that we have a relatively small group of students, just less than 40 students. So by middle of the semester, you will be really getting to know each other and like hopefully mutually enriching experience in terms of cultural exchange. So it's good that you chat with each other and like talk to each other. Okay, how are we going to study Korean society and culture? I have emphasized that history is very important, right? So just learning history is not enough. I think history is something that the actors today constantly bring in their own everyday lives. So for you as a college student or as an intellectual who try to understand different culture, try to have this kind of historical perspective when you observe certain social phenomenon or social behavior that you observe in everyday life. Another way or methodological perspective that I would like to emphasize is sociological understanding. And what do I mean by sociological understanding? I know that many of you are sociology major, right? So probably you all know what sociological approach is, right? Social phenomenon is a result of interaction. So interaction is very important among different actors. So we have these people here, right? We have 40 people. We are interacting with each other. And there are certain social factors, which I will explain a little bit later. But what we see now and here, whether that is a food whether that is a book, or whether that is a clothing, is actually it is constructed by our interaction with each other. The meaning made by interaction with each other. So we have to understand these actors and the way these actors behave and how their behavior and interaction actually produces the meaning that is attached to certain things, right? So, for example, kimchi, we eat kimchi, right? We eat kimchi. And or maybe jjigae together for a meal. And having a meal is more than just eating a meal. It's something that through this kimchi, we probably will kind of think of Korean identity. In many cases, Koreans say, well, kimchi is our, you know, it's our body and also our identity. Right. So you go to somewhere and then you eat kimchi, not just because you like kimchi, but also it symbolizes a very important aspect of Korean food, Korean dietary system. Kimchi and rice is kind of very basic meal for Koreans. And then since you have been like learned to eat kimchi and rice from your very early childhood, from maybe your mother, your parents, and so on. So when you travel to the U.S., you'll say, that, well, after a few days, you'd like to have kimchi and all. And then, wow, this is really a real meal, right? And probably eating a dinner, if it was to be something that is like more rich, you'd rather eat meal with your friends or family rather than by yourself, right? It's kind of collective thing that you would like to do together with other friends. So it's kind of friendship, your community belongings, and so on. Another important aspect of sociological approach is like going beyond the surface. So you have to, you'll try to go deeper and come up with some kind of explanation. Of course, you'll see a certain social phenomenon, and then after that, you know this some facts, and then you'll try to go deeper and try to provide some explanation of why and how and so on. So asking these kind of questions are very important. One example of this could be sex ratio. I mean, this is kind of just number, very descriptive numbers, right? What is sex ratio?
He told me not to move, but I ought to. What is sex ratio? I know that there are some like mature sociology major, upper year major sociology students. Baek Jong-un? Sex ratio, what is sex ratio? Yes, yeah. Can you be more, I go to, yeah. Can you be more concrete?
여성을 100으로 놓고 여성을 100으로 놨을 때 네, 남성의 그 숫자를 의미합니다.
In English?
number of males? Number of males? For 100 females. Wow, thank you.
Yeah, thank you, I appreciate that, yes. Number, I mean, simple, right? Very simple. Number of males per 100 females, okay? So that kind of way of showing this balance or imbalance of gender
between this gender ratio of the male and females. So it's just numbers. But this number, if we go deeper and go beyond, we can actually understand a lot of things about Korean society and Korean culture and Korean social change. So this particular table is something that I have prepared to show some social changes and some mechanisms of for this particular population or demographic behavior as a group in Korean society. If you take a look at this numbers, there are a number of interesting information which waits for explanation. Okay, you can see that in general. So again, the number of males per 100 females, it shows how balanced the male and female is at birth. This is at birth, actually. So this is this number. 1985, we had 9.5 more males per 100 females. So we have more baby boys, boys at the birth. Quite a big difference, right? 116.5. And then we see some similar trend in the 1990s, but we see decline to 160.9. It is generally said that in a natural setting, there are more baby boys born because boys are weaker. They have higher infant mortality rate. They die young. So kind of in a natural environment, we have more boys, and then some will die young, and so that they will have some balance with it, the period of mating years. Okay, so it's say that about 103 to 108, that's kind of natural number. But if you have more than 110, that is not really natural. There's something, or there is some social process involved in this number. Okay. But we can say that now it's quite within kind of normal range, 103 to 108. So we can say that now it's okay, but there must be something going on, in these years. Okay. Another thing is that this is the order of birth. First child, second child, and third child, third plus child. What we see here is that first baby seems quite all right, right? Yeah? Just like, and then, and the second child, 117, and third plus child, this is unbelievable, right? It's like, how can there be more, like, more, twice more boys than girls? It's very unnatural, we can say that, right? This. So we, as a sociologist, we're sociologists, we'll try to provide some explanation of this phenomenon. Okay. What would be? Let's start with 1990, right? Because that's the extreme case, extreme year. Why? What is the mechanism of this high sex ratio? Okay. What is the mechanism for this for this high sex ratio? I mean, there are a lot of folks saying about how to get a boy. I mean, like, if you eat more meat, males eat more meat, like, and then you will have boy. That's, or if you eat less 국물, like if you have soup, you say, well, if you have like seolleongtang, don't drink up the liquid, that because that will lead to a female baby. Like, I mean, my grandmother used to say that, don't eat all this like soup because you won't have female. It's a different way of like trying to have more boys in the traditional culture, right? So what is this called? Like, so it looks like there is something, some cultural message that they would like to have a boy, right? So that's called boy preference. Boy preference. So it looks like at least in 1990s, in the 1990s, it seems like Koreans or Korean couples wanted to have a boy, right? And that's called boy preference. This is kind of cultural norm, if you will, that has been inherited for many hundreds of years, or if not thousands of years, right? Does Chinese have this boy preference? Yeah. Okay, yeah. And where does it come from, do you think? Tradition.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it's a tradition, the social convention. Oh, maybe. I think so. I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. looks like many parts of the world do have this culture of boy preference. He used the term tradition, right? In a traditional society, boy preference is widely found. It's widely found. Maybe it has something to do with agriculture. I don't know. I mean, it's like in agriculture. Male labor was more important, and it's like usually bringing in the female and have babies, and in many cases more babies, more boys, and so on. So, and then maybe especially Confucianism kind of emphasized that the first boy kind of inherits the family line, and then inherits this rights, this ancestor worship, for example, which was a very important part of this family tradition, that also. So maybe Confucianism, agricultural society, all this kind of thing had led to this culture of boy preference, okay? But is it enough? If boy preference was very important cultural norm of traditional society, why suddenly in 1990s we have this very high number of sex ratio? So this could be an important factor, but we should go further and go beyond. There should be some other explanations. What could be a factor for this? Huh? Somebody's
development of the science.
The science.
Yeah, I think abortion rate gets higher, and if they have some girls, yeah, they do those abortion thing, yeah, so they get the boy. Yeah.
Got it. So yes, we have boyfriend preference, but also Sonuk mentioned that we have this medical development, especially so-called sonogram, which can identify the gender of the fetus. Because this, as I said, this is not natural, it's a very unnatural number, right? This number, 192.7, to say very crudely, means that there could have been maybe almost 90 female fetuses who have been aborted, who have been killed, if you will. Okay, so how? How do you know this? If you were to do the abortion, you should know the gender of the fetus, right? And that's only available because medical development of sonogram. So many, in the 1990s, it became widely popular among the pregnant women, right? So medical development, especially the sonogram, the availability of the what did I do wrong? Yeah, okay. Medical development of sonogram actually made it possible for the couple to actually abort the female fetus. Okay, so this so-called technological development actually has made great impact on this particular social phenomenon of high sex ratio. Another factor that we should consider is the family system. Even though I said this pregnant woman decided to have abortion, sometimes it was more than just individual choice. That is, in many cases, pregnant woman felt the pressure to have a boy. This pressure, it may be a factor of kind of internalization of this boy preference, but in many cases, this was something that she felt from the opinions of her husband or from her mother-in-law or father-in-law, okay? Or whole family system. If say that this pregnant woman, her husband is the first son or the only son of his father, and then she feels this pressure that I should have a boy. I should have, I mean, maybe implicit, sometimes implicitly there was some social pressure from their parents-in-law, sometimes maybe more direct, explicit pressure to have a boy. So having an abortion, I would argue, is more than just personal choice in this context. It was like kind of familial pressure. It shows the fact that Korean marriage in many cases, or Korean family, is more than this unity of the couple, male and female. It's more than that. In many cases, marriage involves two different families, and often the husband's, the male's family is probably more important in terms of this decision making and so on. So this shows this very strong family influence on this particular decision making process. Okay, so that's something that we need to consider when we are looking at this particular phenomenon. And another factor that we need to consider is that the role of the government. Or the policy, okay? It seems nothing to do with, I mean, this is, well, you know, marriage, pregnancy, abortion, seems like a very individual, like personal behavior. What does it have to do with the government? Any response? Does Korean government have something to do with this phenomenon?
Maybe the Korean government discouraged family to have less number of children, and so that's why they chose boys rather than girls if they had to have just three children.
Excellent. Did you got it right? This is very important. The Korean government have maybe I should go there. Okay. Korean government has very firmly supported family planning program, that is, you should not have two babies. Sometimes we'll talk about it deeper, but sometimes they, well, one baby is enough, okay? So maybe in China, I know that's one baby policy, right, still, you know? And in Korea, was the Korean government was very successful in the 1960s and 70s in imposing this kind of idea that you should not have many babies, let's have two. It's more encouraging to have one, like, and so on. So in a sense, these couples had very little choice in terms of the number of the babies they could have. And then still they still have this boy preference. If they could have maybe eight children, they could say, well, you know, let's see what happens and let's try one more time, second time. And it's like, this is my personal case, but it's really the probability is like 50%, like it's like 50%, 50% to have a boy, right? Boy or female, but the statistics is not always, probability is not always working. So I have four uncles, right? And my eldest uncle had one boy and eight daughters. And my uncle thought that if you have eight children, he might have like four boy, but that's not really happening. It's a very independent event, right? 독립사건이죠. 그 아들 딸 낳는 건. So and then my second uncle had eight daughters, and my father, the third one, and he had three daughters and me, one boy. It was a great success for my father. And my the youngest uncle had three daughters. So it's like, but at least what happened was that this older generation, they thought that if they had like many, because they were free to have as many babies as possible, as they wanted. And if they had like maybe 10 babies, and they might have a couple and so on. So it was quite, they had this room to actually get more relaxed. But as I said, as the government was strongly encouraging people to have less than two babies, they were desperate. They said, well, for the first one, let's see what happens, okay? And then second one, they became kind of, well, you know, this is something we should do something, or maybe not, like, because they know that it's wrong to like have abortion for the, based on the gender, and this is what happens, but still the number kind of increased, but not to the extreme. And then what happens? Let's say that a couple had two babies, two daughters, and there's this pressure from their extended family, and they have this boy preference, and they could use sonogram to determine the gender. So they decide, well, let's try to have a third one, but let's be very careful in terms of choosing the gender of the fetus. So for the third one plus, you see this like very high number of male boys. So that's something that you can find from this particular table. And I think that's very sociological understanding. And actually another the important impact of the government policy, I think, is that I don't know exactly what the numbers are today, but abortion rate was extremely high in Korea in the 1970s and 80s, and even 90s. Okay, I don't know today, but and that I think has a very shameful number, because abortion not based on this like pregnant woman's choice or something like that. It's like in the 1960s and 70s, Korean government was so obsessed with population decrease. They wanted to reduce the number of the baby, but they said, well, you know, in addition to contraceptives, they would say, well, abortion is a very efficient way of a family planning program. If you're pregnant, like have the baby aborted. That means that they could reduce the number of the baby. So there's this kind of very instrumental understanding of the pregnancy and abortion was quite popular in the 60s and 70s. So we had a very high, extremely high number of abortion, which is, I mean, it's like really, I think, a very shameful fact of Korean history. And I think that kind of attitude made people to think that abortion is not really an important issue at all for many, many couples. So in that respect, this very strong government interrupting, intruding this personal life is actually reflected in this number, okay? And then you see this change, the decline of the numbers, right? What happened was that actually government became very serious about this fact. There were many voices from women's organizations about how inhumane this behavior is. So they have, they had a law, of course, they had a law. So they were very, they imposed this law to these medical clinics. They said that you should not this, because they had this regulation on the sonogram and abortion in the 1990s. But many private clinics, just they had the sonogram done and abortion done. And then the government became much more serious about this issue. They began to really impose this rule, saying that no, no, you shouldn't do this. So they get fines, they get, sometimes they get prosecuted and so on. So they began to, many medical clinics began to become very selective in terms of the abortions. So the number began to decline. And another factor I think is that we see this decline of the boy preference, a very significant decline of boy preference. And if you see these recent surveys, many couples actually prefer the girls. They would rather have girls rather than boys. But I think cultural change, so boy preference is declining, right? Medical development or this restrictions, regulations and control by the government. And maybe also this family influence is kind of less important. So now it's couples are more important than their in-laws and so on. And government has become more strict about this imposing of this the controlling of the abortions and so on. So it's all these factors together have been affecting the number of the sex ratio number. And even though it's not on this table, if you look at this number in terms of geography in the 1990s and in the 2000s, the number was very high in certain part of Korea. Can you guess which part of Korea had the highest number of sex ratio? The area which had the highest boy preference, very traditional, very Confucius. Which part of Korea is most conservative, if you will, or traditional? Seoul or Gyeonggi, Jeolla, Gyeongbuk, Gyeongnam? 어디, which province is most conservative and Confucius? 투표하면 새누리당 많이 나온 데가 어디죠? 경남이에요? Yeah. 경북 is the most conservative, I think. Yeah. So, for example, to those who have not been to this place, there is a very traditional, very Confucius community in Gyeongsangbuk-do province called Andong. It's part of northern Gyeongsangbuk-do. And this place is, I mean, you'll see this, if I think you should visit them, this place also, this foreign students. It's a great place to actually feel and actually meet this very traditional, maybe Joseon Dynasty culture, even though like it's kind of slowly changing, but still you can see this very old traditional culture and very conservative. And they used to have very highest sex ratio, this northern Gyeongbuk area, northern Gyeongbuk, Uiseong, Andong, and so on. So it was, if you look at the table, it was just amazing how high the number was in this particular region. But according to the latest, over the past few years, the number has been really declining rapidly as well in those areas as well. So you can see this boy preference is really declining in Korean society, and many young couples would rather have baby girl than baby boy. And I mean, this is another issue, but why do the couples want to have girls than boys? And some people say that, well, boys are not fun to raise, right? Or some people say that boys are expensive because you have to prepare the housing when he gets married and so on. There are a number of different explanations for girl preference nowadays, but it's not sociologically well-established research area, so let me just move on. Okay, so this is kind of approach that I would like to encourage you to adopt. That is, try to go beyond what you see. Try to provide some explanations. We will begin with some very descriptive snapshots of Korean society, and then maybe try to rethink and go deeper, and then try to come up with some kind of explanation. Methods. I think this is very important. I mean, this has something to do with your team project. In the middle of this semester, I will ask you to write a short proposal of your research project, and then I will I would like you to think about how you're going to conduct your research, what kind of method that you'll be using. Okay. And this is kind of typical. There are maybe two typical method for social research. One is survey, very simple survey, right? You distribute questionnaires and you collect data. Survey research is a research method in which subjects respond to a series of items or questions in a questionnaire on an interview. So you make some questions, well, what do you think about Korean food? Like, what is the best food that you like? And blah, blah, blah. That's, you know, survey. And then you maybe you ask like 100 students at KU, and you say that, well, KU students really like the favorite food is, I don't know, 부대찌개 and things like that. That's and then you come up with some means, averages, and like distribution of the answers and so on, right? And then you try to explain why or what and so on. So political attitudes and religious beliefs, and maybe relations between variables. That is, going back to this example of survey of food, you say that, well, maybe these students at College of Liberal Arts like 부대찌개, whereas students at School of International Studies are like pasta. And then maybe you come up with this kind of like numbers and you try to explain, right? And maybe you say that, well, the reason is because maybe students at School of International Studies had more exposure to foreign countries, they've been to foreign countries as well, and so on. So that you can come up with some interesting explanation by conducting a survey, okay? Trying to see some relationships between variables, your education level, your year, what college you belong to, and so on, right? Excuse me. It's a very rough description of survey method. Another method that could be used is qualitative research method. I know that there was a student from anthropology here, anthropologist? No? Okay, no. He was here, but he's not here anymore. Okay. Participant observation, in-depth interview. This is more maybe informal and try to understand what the people under study is really feeling and thinking. We do not start with some assumptions or structured questions. You in a natural setting, especially if you're doing a participant observation, you're trying to become part of that community or part of that group or part of that members, and then try to hear what are the issues of them, what are the voices of them, and so on. So it generates kind of qualitative data for interpretation, and it helps us to understand their or insider's own view. Got it? It's quite a very sketchy explanation of, because maybe you will need one semester to study quantitative method and then another semester for qualitative research method. Okay. But don't worry, you will do fine, because I know that many of you have already taken method courses, and I think that could be used for. To give you some idea of how this method is being used, can be used, I will show you some sample of the previous research that has been done by the students. For example, one research team has done a research on the topic of education in Korea, and they look into the school system of Korea, and then they actually have prepared survey and collected data of high school students and asked them how many hours do you study, do you go to like private tutoring and 사교육, private학원, and also how many hours do you use computer, how many do you like talk to your parents, and so on. So this are number of questions in a structured questionnaire, and then they kind of gathered the data and did a very simple statistical analysis of the means and so on. Another team is Cafe Culture. They have actually made a map of cafe on around KU campus, and then they did a survey of the college students at KU. How often do you like visit cafe, or why do you visit cafe, or how many hours do you spend time at the cafe, and so on. And they come up with a very interesting idea that, well, cafe is more than just a place for drinking coffee. It's like where you like study together, or sometimes independently study there, and so on. Gay community. Well, can you 다른 파일을 내가 잠깐 보여주려고 그러는데. USB 오면. 그 PPT 파일 다른 게 있거든. 지금 이거. 오케이, this is I think a fascinating example of what you can do during the semester. This was done last spring, spring of 2011. And 잘 보이나요? It's like a, it's a clip from I think a video. But what they have done is they have like done a study of gay community in Korea. They come begin with some kind of background of what gay culture is and what are the terms that are used and so on. This queer terms like coming out and so on. Lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender. Homophobia, the rainbow. So these are, I mean, you can see this guy here, second on the right. He's a famous entertainer in Korea, right? What's his name? Yeah, Hong Seok-chun. It's he's one of the very rare person in Korea who came out. Who did coming out? He said, "I'm a gay," right? And this is Itaewon area. Itaewon area where like it's quite a popular place for a gay community. And the rest are the students who took my course. So just like you, they decided to go to this particular area and then actually do some deep in-depth interview and participate in like their activities. I think it's very time consuming, but at the same time very exciting experience for them. So they you can see that there were I think there were a couple of like students from one from the US, one from Australia, I think, and the rest were Korean students. So kind of background of what kind of gay culture are around. Because this issue has become quite an important issue, controversial issue in Korea in recent years. So there are a number of movies that actually, they have done some background study of the like academic articles and so on, which I think you should do as well. Some books. They looked at the Constitution. So here you say that marriage in Korea is a making a husband and wife relationship, both men and women, legally. So in Korean, actually, constitution, there is no room for a gay couple. It's like male and female. They have used mixed method, that is, they have done survey of 50 students at Korean university and 50 adults, like people who are more older. And they have asked question like, when I watch homosexuals in the media, there's no repulsion. What percent agree, disagree, and so on, right? If your child or family member turn out to be a homosexual, or would you still support them? And this issue of legalization of gay marriage, gay and lesbian marriage. So the survey method was used here, right? And then they also did a participant observation. They actually went to gay bars and like talked to people there and met us. As for this kind of qualitative research, it's very important that you have a good informant. You should have somebody inside that particular community. So they were lucky to have one of the members of this team had a friend who was a gay, and he kind of introduced other members in that community. So they went to Itaewon, they drink beer, look like, having fun, and they had this map of this area, right? So if you need, I could introduce. They're really having a good time here. Yeah. And then they have done this kind of in-depth interview. This is not really a structured question. They met a few people who are gay, and then they kind of kind of open-ended question to learn about their thought and their feelings and so on. That they learned the Zhonglo is another important area, Mr. Har. This video, I mean, I can. This video clip is not available, but they have some, actually, videotaped their interview with a gay person here. They have this guidelines for videotaping and taking pictures of the gay person. There's some guidelines and rights and legal aspect of the. Okay, so yeah, that's kind of an example of your future research. What kind of things can be done, and as I briefly introduced, you can use maybe survey. I mean, I'm not expecting like large, really systematic survey, but. It's always like easier to do some survey of your own students, maybe on campus, and you try to understand Korean culture through the lens of Korean students at Korean University. Or you can do some kind of qualitative research by some interviews or participant observation, such as what they have done for gay community, okay? So let's take a 7-minute break, and then we'll come back for the final 30 minutes. Okay. The next issue that I would like to deal with is a very simple question of what is society? That is, if we are to study a society and culture, I think we should have some definition of what society is. And may I ask what society is to the student of sociology major? By now, you should know what society is, right? Because I know that many of you have studied society for 3-4 years. And you should have a clear idea of what sociology is and what society is. Anyone? I'll give you 5 minutes to think about. I know it's not his question, right, what society is. There have been maybe hundreds of different ways to define what society is. So I would rather not define what society is. I would rather approach this question by what constitutes a society? Okay, what constitutes society? The components of a society. The first component of a society is people. Let's say that this is a society, right? We have in this classroom a society. Consists of people. That's the very first beginning of a society. You have to have people if you are to have a society. Okay, so that means that this in this particular place, we have 39 students, one TA. By the way, let me take this opportunity to introduce a very important person in this classroom. Why don't you stand up and give a short introduction to the class? Yes. Yeah. This is my first time that I hear him speaking English, and actually very good. I mean, and he's a very important person, not only for this arranging this facility, but also and if you have any question or any request, please ask him. And, he's very nice, very kind person. And so thank you, Jiwoong. And so in this classroom, we have 39 students, one TA and one instructor, right? And so if we are to understand a society called understanding Korean society and culture, this classroom class, I think the very first step would be to understand the people. Maybe we start with counting, okay? That's population. That's population, right? So we have, maybe we said, well, we have 41 people in this classroom, right? The population of this society is 41. And then maybe you can ask, in terms of their role, we say the 39 students, one TA, one instructor, okay? But this is kind of allows us to have a deeper, a better understanding of a society. It's not all, right? Knowing people is not all, but it's like at least it gives you very important information of the society. And then you can ask, what kind of, you can ask maybe, what's the gender composition, right? So we have maybe 20 females and 21 males or whatever, right? Gender is one way of understanding. So because as we have seen in the previous PPT, sex ratio could be a very important factor, right? If you had like in this particular community, society, we have, if we had 39 males, maybe the interaction may be quite different from the interaction now among yourselves, right? Gender is an important factor. And maybe race, right? In this classroom, we have a number of foreign students, if you will, a few from China, from the US, from Canada, from Europe and so on. So this so-called nationality or race or whatever, this is also very important information in understanding a society, okay? So if we are to understand Korean society, it's important that we know the people, the population, the number of the population size, maybe age structure of Korean society, because we know this is going to be a very important topic in a few weeks. That is, we are rapidly aging society in terms of the velocity, the fastest aging in the world. Japan used to be the number one in terms of the rate of aging, but Korea actually exceeds because the life expectancy is growing very rapidly on the one hand, but at the same time, we have very low fertility rate. We have very few babies. So in terms of the whole structure of Korean society, we, in terms of percentage, we have very old people. And this is taking place very rapidly. And this is going to be a very important challenge for the sustainability of Korean society. Okay, anyway, so the point here is that, well, if we want to understand a society, any society, whether it's Korea, and I think China is, will be a very, it will be very interesting because you had this one child policy, right? And then people think about, talk about, even though now they say, well, there are too many people in China, but on the other hand, some demographers say that China will also be facing some aging problem in the next 30, 40 years. And, and that kind of like really slowed down the whole vitality of the economy and society. Yeah. So anyway, so knowing people, the population, numbers and structures of the population is very important and very first step of understanding currency. That's why we'll be talking about the population changes in a couple of weeks in Korea. Another important element of a society is organization or institution. So people are social being, right? People, when people live, they don't live independently. They tend to organize groups and institutions and so on. So the very basic interaction among the people is actually marriage, the family, right? So the family is a very small group, but very important organization which reproduces the family members and actually lead to reproduction of a society. If you don't have family or parents, there will be no reproduction of the family and no reproduction of a society. So family, school, right? You go to school. I mean, somehow this school has become very important for all of you. And actually, this year that you spend for education has been like extended very significantly, right? So maybe in the 1970s, if you graduate from high school, that was enough as an adult, educated adult, to get a job, to become a political actor. But nowadays, like I think college attendance rate of Korea is the I think like among the top in the world. More than 80% of the high school graduates go to college, right? So and people talk about, you know, how costly it is socially to provide most people the college education in some cases, which is not really necessary. But anyway, nowadays, like majority of the young people, high school graduates go to college, and actually quite a high percentage of them actually go to graduate school, like Jiwoong, and it's, so it's quite an interesting phenomenon that modern people have to prepare much longer period of time to actually work and actually do some economic activities compared to maybe mid-20th century, right? It's, I mean, interesting phenomenon. Religion, for example, you go to church, you go to temple, a Buddhist temple, and you have a religion, and that really affects yourselves and this society. And in general, Korea is regarded as multi-religious society, right? Buddhism and Christianity are very important religions. And in general, there are very little religious conflict, if you will, compared to certain part of the world. And people come up with some kind of explanation why. And also, if you look at, but maybe there's less conflict at an official level or more bigger structural problem. But in everyday lives, such as ancestral worship, you'll see some small, delicate religious differences among the members of the family and so on. We'll talk about these kind of issues in the following weeks. And I think religion is also one important institution for us to understand any society, and is also for Korea. And of course, business. We talk about the economic changes and Korean society. The members of Korean society have very strong loyalty to their workplace, the companies they work for, right? So if you are an employee of the Samsung or if you're an employee of Hyundai, you have very strong commitment to your company, even though they say that it's rapidly changing. But still, I think compared to other part of the world, workplace is very important for Korean adults. They spend lots of time for their company. Their complete loyalty to the company is expected. And in general, the company provides, you know, a lot of services to the employees. And so I think this kind of organization, how these organizations are affecting ourselves, are very important in understanding Korean society. Another important element, of course, is culture or symbolic structure. Because I guess people, the first component, people are easy to find. it's visible, right? You can actually count the number of people in this classroom, right? Or we can say that the organizations, whether it's family, school, or church, is also very visible, right? But even though we knew these two elements, that is people and organization, that's not going to be enough, right? Even though we know the number of people, structure of the population, or if we know, even though we know the schools and churches and so on, there's something missing. There's something that is less visible. That's symbolic structure. There's something, it's kind of cognitive map, if you will, the way we think, the way we behave, the way we think that what is right, what is wrong, what is accepted behavior, and so on. This should be also learned in order to understand a society or a Korean culture, right, Korean society. When I was when we were taking a break, like 20 minutes ago, 15 minutes ago, when I encountered you in front of the door,
smoking.
Yes, she was smoking. And what I find it very interesting was that she kind of like, she was smoking, and then when I passed her, she kind of tried to kind of like hide her cigarette. Yeah. And I was, oh, I quit smoking in 2005. And I smoked a little bit, a couple of months during my sabbatical. And my official sabbatical ended on the 31st of August, which is a couple of days ago. And I said, well, I'll be smoking only during my sabbatical. And so I quit smoking on the 30th, a few days ago. And still have this temptation. Anyway, I must confess. But anyway, it was interesting that she kind of tried to, maybe not explicit, but kind of like, and why did you do that?
Well, first of all, I don't like to smoke in public places. Like, I'm wary about the people who walk by and stuff, so I don't want the smoke to get into that. But it does come into conflict with my want to smoke. And also because it's a, like, I understand that sensitivity to smoking kind of differs between societies and between like contexts. In Canada, for example, a lot of people are very, when they see like a young person smoking, they're very kind of almost, not intrusive, but just like, oh, why are you smoking? You should stop smoking. And I've also encountered, I don't really encounter that here, but because I've been conditioned to kind of that expectation or that situation back there, I'm just kind of really so I'm just kind of really sensitive about it, and yeah, I don't really like talking about it so much to other people.
Yeah, but I think I might have a kind of like my own cultural lens in interpreting her behavior. That is, in Korea, in general, young people are not really allowed to smoke in front of the elderly, older people. So students, my graduate students, there are some smokers, they wouldn't smoke in front of me because it's kind of hierarchy and that's kind of cultural norm that even though I smoke, they would just like, if they want to smoke, they would go out to like, if we were in the restaurant, they would go out and smoke and then they came back and so on. So there's like, even smoking in Korea has a certain rule in terms of reflecting the hierarchy, if you will. Okay, so I was kind of thinking that maybe you had acquired Korean culture, but I was maybe interpreting from different Korean culture perspective. Yeah, but you'll see that in this everyday behavior. Maybe you may have recognized or learned that, like if you're drinking together, they would pour to each other. And maybe for the elderly, if older person give you, if your professor provides you drink, you would use two hands and so on. I mean, this is something that you could easily learn, right? So but this is not written in the Constitution, right? It's not written in Constitution or a book, but it's something that you learn. It's a kind of symbolic map within your brain that you have acquired through your maybe younger years, children, and so on. But it's important. I mean, it's like if you do not really understand this cultural code, it will be very difficult to learn a particular society, right? So learning people, numbers, and learning organization is much easier. But the symbolic structure is something that it's not really written in the law or something like that. It's something that you would learn from the members of that particular society. So if you go to any different society, that you will probably have to interact to learn this very delicate rules of this particular society. Okay, symbolic structure is also very important to understand. So we'll, when we talk about culture, such as maybe actually Confucianism and like this traditional values will be discussed. But at the same time, as I have emphasized earlier, the culture itself changes, right? So this particular behavior regarding smoking could change very rapidly because you know, it's through these interactions and so on, like people began to accept certain or develop certain new rules, right? We know that Korean society is becoming much less hierarchical, right? Much more individualized. And so what will happen in the next 10 years is something that we have to wait and see. And in that respect, culture is not a thing. It's a process, continue to like evolve and develop. And so just a footnote, and if so we were having a beer together with my graduate students, and if I smoke, and then I know that a couple of my graduate students smoke, and they say, well, go ahead, it's okay. And then the graduate student will say, well, I'm all right. And then maybe after a couple of like saying no, they would smoke. And then it's like, but it's like, it would regard it as a kind of more polite way of, because after refusing a couple of times, you know, he shows that he respects this kind of culture. And if you just smoke right away, I would say, well, this is not really very polite. It's like very delicate way of interaction, and which is quite difficult. But I guess another footnote that I would like to add is that often this kind of cultural norms are very generous to the outsiders, if you will. Outsiders. So if you're from other countries, and you're not like, you're quite free to actually behave, and it will be interpreted as like, well, it's quite interesting, and like, and they will very delightfully tell that this is Korean culture, but you're okay, you can do whatever you want, and so on, right? Let me stop here. I mean, let me stop here about Korean culture. I was going to like go around and introduce each other, but I guess we only have 5 minutes. I don't think that's really enough. Let me stop here. And on next Tuesday, please come read. We are a little bit behind. I mean, it's, I don't know what to do with students from China, but on the syllabus, it says September the 4th, that's today, we are supposed to read Kyung Dong Kim's first chapter. Please read that chapter next week. You will kind of behind about a week. And I will in the first maybe 15 minutes, I'll have to give some introduction of this class again to the students in China, and then we kind of move on to modern changes in Korean society. So when you come to this class, please read page 26 to 41 of Kyungdong Kim. All right, let me stop here.